So, thank you for a very warm welcome. My name is Oliver Siebering. And the theme is the migrant policy and integration as a challenge for the German public administration. Here you can see Spain and Catalonia. Spain has 46 million inhabitants and 505,000 square kilometers. Catalonia, 7.5 million inhabitants and an area of 32,000 square kilometers. For a short comparison with Germany, Germany has 82 million inhabitants and is not as great as Spain. Germany has only 357,000 square kilometers. It's divided in 16 federal states. Here you can see the 16 federal states. I was born here in Paderborn in North Rhine-Westphalia. Then I worked in Dresden. Thomas de Maizière was my boss for a few years. Thomas de Maizière is the interior minister of Germany. He is living in Dresden in Saxony. Then I went to Düsseldorf, to North Rhine-Westphalia back. It's a very rich town. And now I am living here in Ludwigsburg. It's near Stuttgart. Dresden is beautiful. Düsseldorf is beautiful. Stuttgart is not so beautiful. And they don't play good football like Barca. I saw the match yesterday. I was surprised. Messi was very good. And they beat Madrid and was happy yesterday. Yes. For a short comparison. And Germany is in a good economic situation, but we don't have very high economic growth rates. Here you can see the growth rates of real gross domestic product in percent. In Germany, in 2014, 1.6, then 1.7, 1.9, 1.6, 1.8. We haven't so a huge economic growth. Look in Spain, 3.2, 3.2, 2.3, 2.1. In the next year, Spain will have a higher growth of real domestic product. And the Eurozone is in the middle field, yes. And Germany is in a good situation, but not they have not very high economic growth rates. Huh? All think, oh, Germany has very high growth rates. No, but we have a very good budget situation. Here you see the new debts on the left side. Here you can see the total debts of the right side in percent of the GDP, gross domestic product. And here you can see Luxembourg, Germany, and Iceland had a budget surplus in 2016, a budget surplus. France and Spain not, but I think it's not a great problem. In 2010, Ireland had a deficit of 30%. Yeah? In 2010, Ireland had a deficit of 30%, and now it's a better situation, and Germany has a very good actual budget situation. But if you see the total debts, Germany isn't quite good. The total debts, 68% of the GDP, we are only in the middle field. Spain has nearly 100%. Yeah? Here you can see Greece, 180%. Here you can see Italy, 133%. Debts in portion of the GDP. But what's the problem in Germany? In Germany, in 1991, we had very low debts. Yes? 39% of the GDP. And what happens in 1919? We had the reunification in Germany. And we must build up the eastern part of Germany. And that costs a lot of money. And so you can see the debts are rising, rising. And here you can see the economic crisis, 300 or 400 billion euros. But in the last years, the new debts were against zero. We have made new debts. Now our actual situation is very good. But in the last 25 years, our debts increased because of the costs of the reunification. We must build up the eastern part of Germany. And here you can see the unemployment rate in the EU. Here, the red line represents Germany. In 2006, we had the highest unemployment rate, 10.6%. And it's decreasing since then. And this is the economic crisis, only a little bit. Yes? Only a little bit, but it's decreasing. And we think in the next years, the unemployment rate is decreasing further. And here you can see Greece and Spain in 2006 had a lower unemployment rate than Germany. But due to the economic crisis, it raised. But in the last years, it decreases again. But in Germany, it's decreasing since 2005. Here you can see the number of unemployment in Germany. Shortly after the Second World War, we had a lot of unemployment. And then in the 60s, we had no unemployment. This is the first oil crisis. This is the second oil crisis. And this in 1919, we had the reunification. And in East Germany, the unemployment rate increased a lot. This is due to the reunification. And the GDR, the years before, we hadn't any unemployment. But after 1919 in East Germany, the unemployment rose very high. And in 2005, we had the peak. Nearly 4.9 million were unemployed. And then you can see the sharply decreasing of the numbers of unemployed. And we're thinking it's decreasing furthermore. We have 2.6 million unemployed. And here you can see the unemployment rate in 2005, the peak, yes? And here you can see the unemployment rate in 2016. In East Germany, we had an unemployment rate of nearly 20% 10 years ago, yes? Because in the GDR, the east part of Germany, a lot of companies went bankrupt shortly after reunification, and they can't compete with the West German or West European companies. And so we had a very high unemployment rate in the east part of Germany, 20%. And now it's sinking a lot. Now in Thuringen, we have 6.7 unemployment rate. And the strongest region in Spain, Catalonia is the strongest region, and in Germany, Bavaria and Baden-Württemberg are the strongest regions. We had an unemployment rate of 3.5%. And in this region, in the south, in Baden-Württemberg and Bavaria, we have an unemployment rate of nearly 2%. Yes, we need employees. And what's the reason for this decreasing? You can see the number of unemployed is sinking, but we haven't so huge economic growth rates. What is the main factor? It's the birth rate in Germany. We have one of the lowest birth rates in the EU. Here, look, the blue line represents West Germany, and the red line represents East Germany. In the 60s, I was born here, every woman had 2.5 children. And here you can see we have no 1.4 children per woman. And here you can see, as it's a very low birth rate, one of the lowest in the EU. And here you can see the red line, you can see is the birth rate in East Germany. And here, shortly after reunification, it's sinking to a level of 0.77, a very low birth rate. Because there was uncertainty, high employment, and a lot of say, we don't can get children. And this low, very few people were born in East Germany, and 25 years later, they are coming on the labor market. Only a few people are coming on the labor market, and a lot of old people are retired and get pensions. this is the main factor why the unemployment rate is sinking so much, yeah, in East Germany. In 2005, 20%, and now 7%. It's decreasing furthermore, rapidly. Not due to the economic growth in East Germany. So that have a great influencing factors due to the demographic change. Yeah, 300,000 workers are going more to the retirees than new come on the labor market. 300,000. This number is increasing from year to year. We have an increase in labor force. More women are working, and a little bit more elderly are working. In the last year, 65 was a lot of people worked till they're 65. Now they work till 66. Yeah? And they were asked by the company, could you stay longer in our company because of the low unemployment rate? Oh, sorry. And so minus 300,000 due to the demographic change, this number will increase in the next years rapidly. And we had more immigration in 2015, especially from South and East Europe, 2030. So the labor force increased in 2015 by nearly 100,000. But we need, economists say, we need more immigration because this number will increase in the next years, rapidly. And here, the blue bars show the immigrants in 2014, and the red bars show the emigrants to Germany and from Germany. The most immigrants in 2014, we had nearly 1.5 million immigrants that came to Germany in 2014, and nearly 900,000 are left Germany. And the most immigrants, they come from Poland, from Romania, from Bulgaria. Yeah? A lot of are coming to Germany, but a lot of Poles, Romanian, and Bulgarian are leaving Germany. It's a surprising, it's not very surprising, because a lot of came and worked for a few months in the agriculture sector, and they leave Germany after a few months back to their home countries. And it's interesting, 10 years ago, no man or woman from Italy came, no man or woman from Spain came, but due to the economic crisis, more Italians and more Spanish people are coming to Germany. Yeah? But a lot of people are going back because life quality in Spain is better than in Germany. Because we have, seen on TV a lot of documents, and a lot of Spanish people came to Germany, but they're disappointed, not from the work. The work is very good, but in the evening, in Germany, there happened nothing. Yeah? And in Spanish, people, they want to go out in the evening. And so a lot of say, oh, it's a good quality of work here in Germany, but life quality is not as good as in Spain. And a lot of Syrian people came, but they not in 2014, 2015, 2016, a lot of Syrian people came. So here you can see some indicators. The unemployment rate of the Germans is very low. Here you see the unemployment rate of the foreigners. It's very high. Here you can see the social benefits rate. Yeah, we call it Sozialhilfeempfänger. For the German, it's not very high. But the foreigners have a very high social benefit rate. And so a lot of economists say we do need more immigrants. And a lot of people say, is it not a burden for Germany? Because they have higher unemployment rate, a lot of people get social welfare, and we have different payments. In 2015, a German employee full-time earned 3,100 euro per month. A foreign worker received only 2,467 euro per month. Yeah? 21% less than their German colleagues. According to a survey, two-thirds of the Germans are convinced that immigration to Germany means a burden on social systems. The economists say we need immigrants, but a lot of people say, oh, no immigrants, yeah? Because they have higher unemployment rate, they get no such huge wage, and the welfare situation is for them not very good. And so the question arises, are foreigners in fact a burden for the German welfare state? Yeah? Because economists say we need them, and a lot of people say, oh, no, we don't need them. Because they are skeptical, because the foreigners are not fully integrated. They have lower income, a lower employment rate, higher unemployment rate, and higher dependency on social transfers. They say, oh, it's more a burden. And two institutes made a cash flow accounting for the year 2012. And they compare all taxes and social insurance contribution paid by a foreigner minus direct expenditure from the state, foreigner, that's the net financing contribution. They try to find out the foreigner are paying taxes, but are they paying more taxes than they get from the state, like welfare contribution? And if they are paying more taxes than they get, then the net financing contribution is positive. If the foreigners get more from the state, yeah, then the net financing contribution is negative. And they made it, the institutions made it for the foreigners and the data for the Germans. And so we get the net tax payments by age and by nationality. And here you can see the net difference is the sum of the tax payments minus the sum of the transfer payments by age and nationality. The red curve represents the foreigners. The blue curve represents Germans. Yes? And here you can see the age. Here you can see the net difference. Here you can see zero. And this is negative, and this is positive. Let's have a look. Yeah? Here, the red and the blue line are nearly the same. It's not a surprise. The net difference is negative in the first years. Yeah? They don't pay taxes, yeah? But they get health public expenditure, they get child allowance, they go going to school. So the net tax payment for the young people is negative. That's not a surprise. And then, after with 20 years, yeah, Germans and foreigners are going to work. And you can see the blue line. And this represents German in average are paying, or is paying 15,000 more to the states in form from taxes, social contribution, than he gets. Yeah? It's positive. That's all not a surprise. But you can see the red line for the foreigners is much slower, yeah, much not as high as for the German. Yeah. And here with 65, yeah, it's decreasing. And here you can see the curve of the German is under the curve of the foreigners. It's not a surprise because it's minus, it's negative, because a lot of people here are paying in the pension system, and here they got the pension. And the German get a higher pension, so this is more deficit than for a foreigner. Yes? That's not a surprise. And what is very important is we have very young foreigners. That's very important. We have very young foreigners, and the German people are very old. A lot of the German people are here. Yes, this is per capita. Yes, and but we must weight it with the number of persons, Germans and foreigners. And if we are weighted, then we have the following result. Here you can see the net tax payments. Every German in 2012 contributed an average positive net financing of around 4,000 euro a year. Yeah? They're paying more to the state than they get from the state. 4,000 euro. And the foreigner are paying 3,300 per year, per capita. So the contribution per foreigner is lower, 16% lower, but clearly positive. Yeah? A lot of people think that is negative, but it isn't negative, it's positive. Yes? And in 2012, we had 6.6 million foreigners. Now we have more, but in 2012, we had 6.6 million foreigners. Every foreigner paid in an average 3,300 euros. That we multiplicate, then the foreigner have a positive contribution to the state of 21.8 billion euros. They are not a burden. They paid more than they get. Yeah? Because the main reason is because a lot of foreigners are very young, 30 years, 35 years, and they pay a lot into the pension system. So they have a favorable age structure. The average age of immigrants is 25. The average age of foreigners is 38. And the average age of German is 46 years. The Germans are very old. Yeah? And positive migration, therefore, lead not only to an increase in the population, but also to a rejuvenation of the population. We are getting younger. Yeah? The people in an average in Germany are getting younger. So we have a problem because we had only set this figure for 2012, and actually for 2012. And a lot of people, foreigners, are very young, but they're getting older. And so we have asked, does the foreign population also have a positive long-term contribution? And we made a generation balance that indicates the average present value of the net contributions from the members of one's age to the end of life. Yeah. Let's have a look. Here we have a generation balance of the German population and the next generation contour balance of the foreign population. Now let's have a look to the German population. Here you can see the age. Here you can see payments to the states, personal income tax, tax on capital, excise duties, VAT. If you buy something, you have to pay VAT. And you have to pay social insurance contributions. And a lot of people get payments from the states, the pension, health, social transfers, child benefits, and education. What is this means? If a German person is born in Germany, then he, on average, pay 108,000 personal income tax in life till the end. Yeah? He will pay, on average, 45,000 tax on capital. He will pay 154,000 VAT. And social insurance contributions, 212,000. That is the payment to the states. He gets, on average, nearly 90,000 pensions, health care, 100,000, social transfers, 47,000, child benefits, 55,000, and education benefits of 113. Payments to the states minus payment from the states, and a person who will born in Germany this is 110,000 higher than the payment from the states. Yes? This plus this plus this plus this minus this minus this minus this minus this minus this is a difference of 110,000. It's a clear positive for a German. And you can see a German, I'm 52 years old. That's not good. You can see the payment is negative. I, on an average, pay 50,000 personal tax, 50,000 tax on capital, 96,000 excise duties as a VAT, and 92,000. So, and here you can see my rent, my pension is very high in average. The healthcare 100,000. I don't need any education more. And child, I'm not very young. I get no child allowances. And you can see this is further positive and this is negative. And so we have a great problem in the future because the Germans are very old. At that time, it's positive, but it will be negative. So here you can see it's positive, and now we make it for the foreigners. Please remember here, if a German person is born in Germany, till the rest of his life, he will pay 110,000 more than he gets. And now a surprise. Here we can see the foreigners. A foreigner who is born in Germany, this is negative. This is negative. And I was very surprised that this is negative. Because also he paid 66,000 personal tax, VAT, 180,000 social contribution, 150,000 pension, healthcare, social transfer, and the social transfer is very high in comparison to a German person, yes? And this is negative. They are not fully integrated in social life. But here, this is positive, and this year is no surprising, it's negative. But in the first years, it's negative. And here, a 45-year-old foreigner, he's living in Germany, has a balance of 8,000 euros to the rest of his life. He will pay 50,000 personal tax, 18,000 tax on capital, nearly 100,000 VAT, 134,000 social contribution, and this is nearly exact the same sum as this year. He gets pension, he gets health care, and he gets social welfare on average, all on average. So that was a surprise for me, because that this is negative. Foreign people are not fully integrated in the social system in Germany. Yeah? Here you can see the line, the blue line for the German, and here you can see the red line for a foreigner. And 110,000, it's positive for a German, but a newborn child, a foreigner, here this is negative. But now we have weighted as with a number of foreigners. And if we weighted it with a number of foreigners, they have a plus of 22,000 euros because they are very young. Because we have a lot of foreigners, they are very young. So the next payments will be positive. And 22,000 euros, a German in average 88,000. It's much higher for a German person than for a foreigner person, but it's still positive. It's still positive. And if we have, if we multiplicate this 22,000 with 6.6 million foreigners, we have an average sum of 147 billion euros. So, actually, the foreigners are not a burden for the German system. Yeah? But do we need the refugees? That's another question. In Germany, we asked the refugees, what is your education? And here, 25% of the refugees say, oh, we have no main school. Because foreigners are not a burden, but if other refugees are a burden, so it's another question. And are they good for the working sector or not? And 25% of the asked refugees say we have no main school. Only 11% have main school, middle school 5%, and higher education 25% of the refugees have a higher education. And not stated, they said nothing, 30%. And I think they have not a high education. Yes? So they have not a very high education, the refugees, coming to Germany. And in Germany, we have a so-called vocational training. After school, you can go to a university and study, or you make an apprenticeship. Apprenticeship in Germany normally lasts 3 years. And you go to the company for a few months and learn practical things. And then you go to a school to learn theoretical things about this specific kind of job. Yeah? And so after 3 years, you get a degree, and the company knows what your ability is. Yes? But other countries don't know this system. And 73.9% have no vocational training. So a company who wants to hire this person don't know what is his ability. And they have not a very high education. They have no vocational training. And so it's very hard to get them into the job. Here you can see the employment of immigration in the course of time. These are data years ago, not the actual data. This means follows. This is the normal immigrants. This is the curve for the normal immigrants. The yellow line is the excess of the refugees. Follow. After 1 year, nearly 30% of normal immigrants have a job. After 2 years, 45% of all immigrations find a job. After 5 years, nearly 70% of the normal immigrants found a job. And here, look this line. After 1 year, 15% had a job as refugees. After 2 years, the refugees, 25% had a job, and after 5 years, only 50% of the refugees had a job. So it took a long way to integrate them into the work. Yes? Because the education is not very high, they have no vocational training. So it's a very great problem in Germany, what to do with them. Here you can see the development of asylum figures in Germany since 1919. Here you can see in 1992, 430,000, 440,000 asylum seekers came to Germany. Here in Germany, in 1992, we had the Yugoslavian civil war. A lot of people from Kosovo came to Germany. And here you can see in 2006, 2007, no one came to Germany. And here you can see 2015, 2016, more than 1 million people, more than 1 million refugees are coming. Yeah? And so it's a problem. No high education, no vocational training, what to do with them. Here, from which countries are the refugees are coming from? In 2016, 36% of the refugees are coming from Syria. 15% are coming from Afghanistan, 13% are coming from Iraq, Iran, Eritrea, and it's interesting, from Kosovo, from Albania, they are coming a lot, but they get no asylum in Germany because only poor, and that's not a reason in Germany to get asylum. Yeah? But if you are from Syria, if you are from Afghanistan or from Iraq, yeah, a lot of people get asylum. Decision and protection rate. It's a complicated table, but here only this. 80% of the Syrian refugees get asylum in Germany. 98%. Nearly every person from Syria get asylum. From Afghanistan, only 55%. From Iraq, 70%. From Iran, 50%. And from Eritrea, 92% get asylum in Germany. Yeah? They came, and nearly every person from Syria get asylum in Germany. And that's a problem. In Germany, a lot of people say, oh, if I see the bomb attacks in Syria, then I think they get asylum. They must get asylum. But in Germany, a lot of people say, we have a lot of people from Tunisia in the last year, from Algeria, yeah, Morocco. And the people in Germany say, no, no asylum to that people. But to the Syrian people, yes, because we see the bomb attacks in the TV. But what's the problem in Germany? A lot of people from Tunisia throw their passports away and say, oh, I come from Syria. Yeah? Because they know if I came from Syria and they believe that I come from Syria, I get asylum. But if I say I come from Tunisia, I have left Germany. And in December last year, we had an attack on the Christmas market in Berlin. It was a Tunisian person. His asylum seekers was rejected. And a lot of Tunisian, Moroccanian people with rejected asylum are going into underground. And that was they don't get money. Yeah? They must leave Germany. But a lot of people don't know, I don't want to leave Germany. Yeah? And they go into the underground. And so this is a fear in Germany, yeah? That a lot of people, not from, yeah, from Syria, we have a few people. We couldn't control our borders 2 years ago. A lot of people from Syria came. Maybe a few people are people of ISIS. Yeah? But our fear is even greater if they are coming from Tunisia, because they don't get asylum. Yeah? And so they make other things, not every legal way. Yeah? But as the asylum application in 2016, you can see nearly two-thirds of them are male, and only one-third of them are female, but they are very young. The refugees are very young. They have no high education, but in Germany we say, they are very young, they can learn everything. Yeah? And we do not know how many people will stay in Germany, but we think many. Yeah? Yeah? Possible they won't go back to Syria if there is peace there, but we don't know. But they need housing, food, clothing, medical aid, and this will cost. Nobody speaks German. The education is not very high. We must make them fit for the labor market, and that will cost. The German government a few weeks ago said in the year 2016, the refugee costs us 23 billion euros every year. For Germany in 2016, 23 billion, that will cost. Yeah? They need housing, food, clothing. Yeah? We must educate them, and this is costly. And I said we have a good financial situation. Here you see the budget in Germany 2016. We had a budget surplus of 23 billion euros. Here, You can see the cost, 23. And it's surprising, we have a budget surplus of 23 billion. But the federal budget is a surplus of 7 billion. The federal states in the whole, a budget surplus 4.7. The communities 3.1. And the social insurance made a surplus of 8.2 billion euros. And in the aggregate, we had a surplus of 23 billion euros. And my opinion is the refugee problem in Germany is not a money problem. Germany is relatively rich. Don't misunderstand me. Not that we are giving away money so much, but this is not a finance problem. If the refugees are coming to Greece or Italy, especially Greece, Greece is not in a comfortable situation as Germany. Yeah? A very high unemployment rate, not a budget surplus, yeah? And they have great problems, but this is not a problem for Germany. And I had a student, he wrote a bachelor thesis. The object of the study is the willingness of companies to hire refugees in a certain town. What are the obstacles? We asked 2,600 companies, we only got 164 answers. And the companies answered, yes, we are willing to employ or to hire refugees, but what are the greatest obstacles? The lack of qualification, 50% said this is a very important thing, and 26 said, oh, it's also important. The lack of language skills is very important. Yeah? The lack of specialist knowledge is very important, and the lack of prior education. And that will cost, and it took a long way to make them fit for the German working market. And we had in the last year a right-wing party, the AfD. It's like Marine Le Pen, but in German. And they was founded in 2013. A very new party. It's a right-wing party, Alternative für Deutschland, Alternative for Germany. And they gained a lot, especially in 2016, when a lot of people, refugees, are coming to Germany. And the AfD is against the EU, like Marine Le Pen, is against refugees, yeah? And they want to go out of the euro. Yeah? This is the AfD. And they gained a lot. And in September of this year, we had general election in Germany. And it is thinking, yeah, we think they get 10 to 12% in Germany. They don't come into power. Yeah? But in federal states, yeah, in Sachsen-Anhalt, yeah, they got 24%. Yeah? Because they say no refugee. And in the east part of Germany, we don't have a lot of refugees. And only 2% of the population in East Germany are foreigners. In East Germany, yeah, the party is very popular, but there live no foreigner. The most foreigners live in the western part of Germany, because in the GDR we had no such a lot of refugees and no such foreigners. And the AfD say no refugees. We had a surplus, but this surplus don't have to go to the refugees, to the Germans. Yes? And what does a refugee get? First, the social welfare for a normal person. A single in Germany gets 404 euro. If you have a job, no problem. If you are fired, you get 1 year 60% of your net wage in Germany. 60% of your net wage. After 1 year, a German gets 404 euros. cash, and the state will finance the rent. Yeah? 404 plus the rent, is that what a normal welfare per person is getting? And a refugee gets 354 euros. Yeah? He's getting not 404. But a lot of the right wing says this is too much. Huh? And so that's a question in Germany, because a lot of say, oh, that's not very much. But if they're getting this, it's much more than a refugee will get in his homeland. And that's another question for them. Oh, I come to Germany. Maybe I find a job. But we need skill workers. That's a gold problem. We need skill workers, and a lot of them have no high education. But if they have no job, they got 354 euros. And a little bit of them are going to send to the homelands. Moltes gracias per la vostra attenzione.
La sessió d'avui té una segona part, que és fer uns grups de debat, i l'Oliver ens ha preparat unes preguntes perquè en aquests grups les treballem, i amb una estoneta després tornem aquí a la sala i les discutirem amb ell. Farem tres grups, al sortir tenim tres aules aquí a l'escola, al sortir us donarem un paperet i són aleatoris els grups perquè estiguem barrejats, i això, us donarem una fotocòpia amb les preguntes que l'Oliver ara farà, i això, es tracta de discutir-les, treballar-les, i necessitem un portaveu de cada grup. L'Oliver té traducció també simultània, si vol, per tant les podeu parlar en anglès o podeu parlar en català, si voleu. S'ha entès bé, suposo? Doncs quan vulgueu. A les 11:30 aquí, no? Espereu un moment que l'Oliver farà les preguntes, però a les 11:30 aquí.
Yes. One question is how to protect the borders. In Germany, a lot of people say we must protect our borders. With money. A few days ago, Italy promised Niger, a country in Africa, to transfer 50 million euros for a better border protection. But look at this. Migrants have sent so much or so many euros to their homelands. In Spain, no detail, but 7,000 million euros from foreigners are sending to the homelands in Africa. We don't know. Yes? So, and Angela Merkel, a few months ago, went to African countries and say, you get a few millions. And they say, look. If they are working in Germany, in Spain, in France, yeah, they get a wage, and a little bit of the wage are they sending to their families in the countries. And so the 50 million you promised me is not very good. It's better for me to do nothing. Or? So with weapons, we have Frontex. And try, now it's spring, summer is coming. I think a lot of boats from Syria are coming over the Mediterranean Sea to Italy, to Greece, with military ships. Yeah? That's one question, how to protect the borders? What shall we do? Yeah? Another is the Dublin Regulation. Is the Dublin Regulation a fair distribution? The Dublin Regulation is an EU law that determines the EU member states responsible to examine an application for asylum seekers. The state in which the asylum seekers is submitted first must carry out the asylum procedure. If it's coming to Greece, it's Greece's problem. Yeah? And a lot of people in Germany think that it's a fair distribution. I think not. Yeah? Is it a fair system? Angela Merkel, our chancellor, said, refugees must be distributed fairly across all EU countries. But in Poland and Slovakia, they said, no, that's not our problem. They want to go to Germany, not to Poland or to Slovakia. Should refugees be distributed across all EU countries according to a certain quota? Yeah? Every state has to put some foreigners according to a certain quota. Is that quite correct? Should we do that? And a fourth question, what should refugees get? Huh? In Germany, a lot of people say, oh, that's too much. What do you mean? A refugee in Spain, Germany, France should get. Is it a really, is it a real thing? Oh, I come to Germany to get this money. That's four questions. Huh? Also, what should refugees get? Distribution of refugees? Should we? Dublin regulation is a fair distribution. Should we have another distribution system? Why is it good for Germany? Because Germany is in the middle of Europe. Yeah? And the refugees come first to Italy, maybe to Spain or to Greece. And Germany can say, oh, not our problem. It's your problem in Greece. I think it's not fair. And protection of the borders. How to protect the borders? What shall we do if, say, refugees come over the sea? And a lot of ships try to push them away back to Syria. Is it correct or not?